Hey folks, it's Jared Manninen from the website tahoetrailguide.com. I just wanted to talk to you a little bit about hiking during spring conditions in the mountains. I find that hiking under spring conditions in the mountains can be a challenge sometimes. I don't always know exactly what to expect, especially if it's been a big snow year. You may find snow patches well into August, September, and October even, depending on what aspect of terrain you're negotiating. The big challenges with hiking in the mountains during spring-like conditions is that the terrain is always going to be variable. You're going to come across dirt sections that are dry and full-on summer mode, but at the same time, you may wind around a mountain or some type of a valley where it has a north or northeast facing aspect that still has snow in it. And depending on what time of the day you're hiking, that snow could be pretty slippery and icy. I've come across many trails in spring conditions where I just turned around because I wasn't prepared with the right gear and or I wasn't really willing to put my life at risk. Even if that section was only 20 feet long, if that's ice, it's not very forgiving, and if you slip, you never know what you're going to land on beneath. So you really have to be conscious and aware of what you're doing when you are hiking. As far as gear goes, when I'm hiking in the mountains during the spring, I'll either take a pair of winter hiking type boots and my snowshoes, or I'll take some light hiking shoes with gaiters and micro spikes. I usually won't mix and match both of them. I got so much gear in my shed that I could pack everything with me and be ready for every exact second, but you're bordering on that whole kitchen sink approach to just bringing everything and then spending half your time putting on gear, taking off gear, repacking gear, pulling gear out of your pack, and you're completely missing the whole experience of being outside. So a lot of times I'll just go for like a two-thirds majority or a three-quarters majority type of an approach to hiking. So for example, today's hike was a vast majority going to be hiking on a dirt trail. I knew that I would be in snow, but I'm not in snow for more than like a mile of my 7 mile route. So I opted for the lighter equipment of light hiking shoes, gaiters, and some foot traction. At the same time, if I'm well beyond my safety level with what gear that I have to, I'll turn back. There's no question about that. The summit is optional, the descent is mandatory. You have to go home safely. Hey folks, I'm going to cut in with a little bit of narration over these demonstration portions of the video, but before I do start talking about what it is that I'm doing, I want to be clear about a couple of things. The first thing is that this is about basic hiking. It's not about advanced mountaineering. Just know that whenever in doubt, turn back. Don't go beyond your skill level, your technical ability, or the gear that you're using when hiking in the mountains in the spring when there's a lot of snow present. Kicking steps, particularly when the snow is relatively soft, is pretty easy and it should be somewhat natural for you to do. You want to create a platform that you can push off from when you're stepping up to the next step. In order to do so, be deliberate about punching your foot into the snow so that you can create that step. Instead of trying to haphazardly walk up the angle, just go ahead and make that flat platform so that you can just make a natural step from one foot to the next as you climb up that soft snow. Another thing I'd like to mention about this video is that I've included a lot of imagery from the months of April and May over many of the years that I've lived here at Lake Tahoe, just to illustrate the fact that when other locations at much lower elevations are working on their gardens, getting their yards cleaned up during the spring, for example, up here at Lake Tahoe, we're still skiing. And it's really hard to understand how much snow is in the backcountry unless you see it firsthand. Snow holds for a long time in the mountains, and you have to be prepared for that. Regardless of whether or not you're going up or downhill in the snow in the mountains, you want to keep your center of mass over your feet.
this is a little bit more important when going downhill, because a lot of people's tendency is to lean back toward the hill as they're going down a steep face of snow, for example. But you want to actually be upright, so you want to be perpendicular to gravity. Just make sure your feet stay under your body when you're going downhill. Sidestepping up or down hill is a little bit more common when you're wearing skis, but you could do it with just your regular snow boots like I'm showing here. I find that it makes it a little bit less scary to go down a steeper angle just because you're not facing directly downhill.
One thing I wanted to point out too, if I haven't made it clear already, or it's not clear by this presentation, is that I'm just talking about hiking as you would hike a summer trail, but you're doing it in the spring at this point. I'm not talking about full-on Mount Whitney mountaineering in March where you're using ice axes, crampons, belays, ropes, all that stuff. I'm not talking about that. I'm just talking about basic hiking and there happens to be snow present. Sometimes there's going to be a little bit more snow, sometimes there's going to be a little bit less snow, but I'm just talking about hiking, not full mountaineering. That said, I'll keep harping on it. If you do run into angles of terrain that are beyond your skill level, turn back. Don't try to attempt to do them because the results could be catastrophic if you're not prepared with skills and gear to handle that type of stuff. So, whenever in doubt, turn back.
As you can probably imagine, there are tons of different options for foot traction devices available that are something less than actual crampons. When I'm out hiking and I know I'm not going to be going up super steep stuff, super scary, icy embankments or anything like that, I'll just take one of these simple foot traction devices with me so I can slip it on and off as needed without making a huge production about it. This specific model I like because it does have very aggressive teeth, it slips on very easy, and it's actually quite secure on my foot when walking. I have a bunch of different styles that have accumulated over the years of foot traction devices, and the vast majority of them, particularly the, I don't want to say cheaper, but the less expensive varieties, tend to torque their way off of my shoes quite easily. But this style that I have on in this clip here tend to stay on pretty solid. When I'm hiking downhill on firm snow using these foot traction devices, I tend to take short and choppy steps so that my feet are always directly beneath me. Again, I don't want to let my feet get ahead of me too far as I'm going downhill because you can end up falling back and then sliding down, and I want to avoid that. I find that it's just way more easy to fall over as I'm going downhill as opposed to going uphill. Going uphill, I normally just walk pretty naturally uphill on firm surfaces, keeping an upright posture. One thing I want to point out about this point of view hiking downhill in this snow, you can see that the snow is progressively getting softer, and that's because that angle of snow toward the bottom has been baked by the sun a little bit more than the top of the hill where I first started hiking down. And these foot traction devices don't really help in soft snow. I only use them for firm snow, which is, again, why I like having a really convenient on and off operation with those foot traction devices.
Time of day is definitely a factor when hiking during the spring in the mountains. Generally speaking, if you hike early in the morning and you're going to encounter snow, be prepared for encountering ice. It'll soften up once the sun starts to bake it and the temperature rises, but if it froze overnight, it's going to be pretty icy and those light hiking shoes just might not be enough. So do a little bit of research before you go, obviously, and find out if there's going to be a lot of northern or northeastern facing aspects that are shielded from the sun for most of the day and take longer to melt out. South facing and west facing slopes are usually pretty dry during the spring, but you never know. There could just be that one section that's ice. So if you leave too early, you may find yourself in a total dangerous and precarious situation that could have catastrophic results. I highly recommend exercising caution if you do decide to hike early in the morning. The flip side of that equation is that if you do decide to hike somewhere where there is going to be a bunch of snow present and wait till it's too late in the day, you may find yourself just constantly post-holing and basically swimming through wet, sopping snow, and that's just as miserable. So if you have the ability, late morning, somewhere between 9:30 and 11:30 is usually the sweet spot where things are still firm enough where you can walk normally to some degree, assuming there was a freeze overnight. Now, if it's really late in the spring and it's not getting any lower than like 35 to 40 degrees at night, you may be walking through soppy, wet snow no matter what. But again, midday, if you're out there noon to four, it's just going to be soup by the time you're out there. So just plan accordingly.
I find that there are very few situations or scenarios when hiking or traveling in the backcountry that rival the frustration that comes with post-holing. But there's at least one trick that I've used to mitigate some of the risk involved with post-holing, and that's to drive my knee forward when I start to feel myself sinking into the snow. And that actually does two different things. One, it prevents my knee from hyperextending. And the second thing is it actually creates more surface area in the form of my shin making contact with the snow. So in theory, I don't sink quite as deep. In most cases, when you post-hole, the natural reaction is going to be to take another step with your other leg to step up out of the hole. But sometimes when you end up post-holing all the way up to your hip, for example, you don't have that option, so in those cases, it's almost better to use your backside or your more surface area in the form of your butt to sit down and pull your leg up out of the hole and then roll away from it and then carry on with your hike. Again, if you end up in the middle of the day across a field of snow or up a mountain of snow that's been getting cooked by the sun, that snow gets soft, it loses its structure, and then you start to sink in. And it can actually be a pretty dangerous thing for two reasons. One, you may end up hyperextending your knee because your foot sinks in and then you continue to move forward. Or you just may find yourself exhausted by the time you end up getting to where it is that you're going because it took so much longer. So that level of exposure that you experience by making this grueling and punishing and irritatingly slow trek across that snow without snowshoes, for example, that can totally just sap all energy and life out of you.
I've obviously focused a lot on travel across snow or dealing with snow during this video because that's really the main crux of the whole spring hiking in the mountains is dealing with snow. When it's dirt, when it's dry terrain, and the trails are clear, kind of like this, it's just hiking as normal. It's not really a whole lot of special considerations, but for spring travel, you definitely have to be prepared for dealing with variable terrain as well as, you know, just the unknown. Who knows, maybe that stream crossing that's usually not more than a trickle by August is a swollen 2 feet deep raging river, and that could be a serious concern and a serious factor in what you end up doing and how far you end up going. Last night I encountered a small water crossing which, you know, was about 4 feet across, but that sucker looked like it was 3 feet deep. I did make the effort and leapt across and made it, but it could have been quite cold and refreshing had I not made it, or I could have wrecked my camera pretty fierce had I submerged that in that little pool of water. You know, that's just kind of part of the adventure of getting out in the spring is you never know what you're going to run into. Part of the gear that I've omitted from talking about as far as spring hiking in the mountains is some type of either ice axe or hiking poles, trekking poles. They're both totally recommended. I just tend to not use trekking poles anymore because I'm mostly taking pictures of birds and wildflowers and that sort of thing, so I like to have my hands free for use with the camera. I will admit that it's a little bit irresponsible for me to not talk too much about self-arrest when dealing with spring conditions in the mountains, but again, at borderlines getting into the full mountaineering deal, and for the most part, your average person, they're not going to own an ice axe. They're not going to be dealing with steep angles of terrain. They're coming up to Lake Tahoe, for example, to hike a fun trail that's a hiking trail, not a mountaineering route. It's just a little bit more than what I want to cover today. And I haven't even really described doing any type of glissading either, which is really fun. I tried it earlier and the snow is so mushy soft that I just sat down into a small depression where I made my own little sitz mark. So obviously I'm wearing this little buff here and covering up my ears. Spring hiking, you can get baked pretty easy by the sun. A lot of times it'll happen where you're walking on snow and all that snow is bouncing up into your face, underside of your nose, your underneath your baseball cap, for example. Yesterday I went hiking and I just had a baseball cap and I totally spaced on wearing any type of sunscreen for my ears and my ears got fried, so I decided this was gonna be on all day today. So anyway, that's a pretty standard thing, just being out in the summer no matter what, is having sunscreen, sun protection. I usually opt for layers versus sunscreen or creams or lotions just because that stuff all ends up somehow getting ingested when I drink water, probably sweat running down and then when I go to take a drink of water. So I usually opt for more of a layer approach than actual sunscreen. Going hand in hand with the idea of protection from the sun is probably hydration. So, you know, these are all lessons that I shouldn't need to tell you this. Drink enough water. You're gonna sweat, especially when you're at altitude or in the mountains. Air is dry and that tends to dry out your sweat, wicks it away really quickly, and you don't feel like you're sweating or perspiring, but you are, and at a pretty fast rate. So, you know, drink plenty of water and have enough calories to get you home safely. Okay, folks, day two of filming. I had every intention of capturing all the footage I needed the other day when I was hiking through the snow. Long and the short of it was, I ended up spending way too much time outdoors and I just needed to head home. And a big part of the problem was the tail end of that hike that I did the other day. I ended up wading through thigh to chest deep mountain white thorn. If you know anything about white thorn, it's also known as one of nature's tax collectors. It was a full-on bloodletting session, complete with barbs of thorns stuck in my thigh and my shins. It was not very good. The silver lining to that last bit of gnarly hiking was that I found a couple of huge patches of Brown's peonies. And if you know anything about Sierra Nevada wildflowers, they're pretty cool to look at. I also happen to get a couple of good shots of a small little house wren that probably was wondering what the hell I was doing in the middle of all that white thorn. The main reason why I wanted to add another day of filming was just so I can cover two more topics that I alluded to but didn't cover a whole lot the other day, and that's wet and muddy trails as well as just water crossings, whether that's a stream or a river. Again, everything with regard to hiking in the spring or in spring-like conditions in the mountains has to do with snow. So you saw me hiking up and down in snowy sections of mountainous terrain and across some flat stuff as well. But at the lower elevations, all that snow is turned into melt and runoff. And what it does is it tends to swell those rivers and stream crossings, as well as put a lot of water on the actual trail. So now you have trails that are not only filled with water, but they're probably pretty soft and muddy. I don't imagine most people prefer to walk directly through water or mud. But as part of the Leave No Trace 7 principles, traveling and camping on durable surfaces, is the small bit about hiking directly down the middle of the trail, whether it's wet or muddy. Once you start walking to the side of the trail or walking around areas that are wet or muddy, you start to really wreak havoc on the local ecosystems, and you end up just destroying the beauty of the trail itself. You could obviously wear a nice pair of waterproof hiking shoes or boots to deal with those wet and muddy trails, but honestly, I usually just pull out the old hiking shoes that have been relegated to yard work and put those to use and put a few more miles on them early in the season. I don't worry about them getting dirty or muddy or wrecked or anything like that. Another thing too is a lot of times I won't even bother with a waterproof shoe. They're usually beefier shoes. They usually provide way more support, but at the same time, they take a long time to dry out. So sometimes I'll just wear a pair of running shoes and those things dry out quickly. Also, if your feet do get really sopping wet, you just take your shoes and socks off and wring them out for a little while. I understand if weather is very cold and you don't want to walk through that cold water because you might be concerned about hypothermia or some sort of frostbite scenario, but you know, that's kind of the risks of dealing with spring hiking conditions in the mountains. A lot of times when you're hiking in the spring in the mountains, it's not just the snow on the ground that you have to concern yourself with. Sometimes it's the stuff that's fallen from the sky. Here I am today in the middle of May, and we got snow. It's not much, but it's definitely been a long, cold, soaking rain that's transformed into snow, which can lead to a relatively dangerous situation if you're not prepared. I say potentially dangerous because this type of weather condition where you end up with mid-30s to mid-40s and cold, soaking rain that transforms into snow like it did last night and this morning, that can lead to hypothermic conditions. You would think that in the dead of winter, that's when you would be at risk for hypothermia. And obviously you are because it's cold. But when it's wet and all your gear gets soaked and there's no opportunity to dry it out, it's really challenging to maintain your core body temperature. So you have to be prepared. The only time I've ever experienced any type of hypothermic condition was years ago in October when I was on a backpacking trip for about, well, the backpacking trip was 5 days. I was planning on staying out for 10, but on that fifth day I just called it because I was just so cold. And it was similar conditions where consistently it was about 45 degrees and overcast, and for about 24 to 36 hours straight I just got hit with cold soaking rains. Anyway, fortunately I was able to get back to a road and get cell service, and I was able to call my friend who came and extracted me from the backcountry, and you know, no harm, no foul, but it was definitely challenging. And again, it was just in this kind of spring or fall, cold temperatures and cold soaking rain experience. People kind of chuckle when I tell them that I don't really consider winter over until Memorial Day weekend, but the fact of the matter is it snowed at Lake Tahoe every month of the year. Yeah, it's volatile weather during the spring, so you have to be prepared with gear. And that usually means bringing, you know, extra layers, food and water, that sort of thing. I'm traveling pretty light today because I'm only hiking a couple of miles from my house. and forecast calls for beautiful blue skies, which is exactly what the last few days have been. So not super concerned about inclement weather, but you know, if there's any chance of stormy type weather, I'll definitely pack a little bit heavier. The thing about hiking in the spring in the mountains is that there's no real way to avoid the effects of the previous winter's snowpack. Now, that's assuming that the previous winter wasn't a drought winter. If the winter was normal in any sense of the word, there's going to be a chance that higher elevations still are holding snow, and lower elevations, especially in meadows and flatlands, are going to be pretty wet. So there's no real secret to finding the perfect place to hike. You can pick trails that might have more of a south and west facing aspect, which tends to be a little bit more drier than the north and the northeast facing aspects of mountains, but you know, you're in the mountains, so you're going to be encountering all of that terrain. It can be a little bit frustrating, but you know, that's part of the mountain experience, and that's one reason why I love it so much, is that you have a different, you're guaranteed a new adventure just about every time you go out.
Okay, folks, that's all I got. I realized I left certain things out, particularly with regard to self-arrest. That's going to be a whole other video eventually, so I'll link that later. But in the meantime, you know, I wanted to talk about hiking. Not mountaineering, but hiking. Getting out on the trails, getting those legs warmed up for the summer, backpacking season, that sort of thing. So if you liked the video, give it a thumbs up. If you have any feedback or questions, post it in the comments section below. Subscribe to my YouTube channel, and then please check out TahoeTrailGuide.com. I appreciate you being here. Take care, everyone.